I don't believe in less. I go all the way. And you can see it in my stride. If good conduct makes a man, it makes me the man of today.
L'espulsione addirittura di Maran.
A man will never run. Stay noble, I say. I am a man. More than the grip of a good handshake and a job well done. Diligence and dedication is what I live from day to day. And you can see it in my deeds. Be true to yourself, I say. Makes me a man of success. Makes me the man of today.
What's up, ragazzi? We are back with another managerial breakdown. This time, we're here to talk about Rolando Maran. What a crazy 12 months has been for the Cagliari manager. He is a former Chievo manager, now managing Cagliari. He's still using his 4-3-1-2 or 4-3-3. But let's get into kind of where he started and how he's gone through his career and where he's ended up now. What's he doing at Cagliari? Okay, so going back to his Catania days, where he started before he was at Cagliari, or before Chievo, excuse me. He used a 4-3-3 there, and so that's kind of where his system began evolving. So the way Maran sets up his system is that the defense is very much involved in the attack. It starts with the fullback. If one of the fullbacks marauds up the pitch and joins the attack, the other three remain back and kind of form like a back three. They're very comfortable in that, and they're very interchangeable. Well, that depending on which fullback goes up the pitch, right back or left back. The other one would stay back, and it would be very comfortable in a three-man defense to make sure there were no leaks in the back, which proved very successful for Catania early on. Another trait early on of Maran's defensive setup, at least, was that they had a very deep line. Many teams nowadays use a very high line. With Catania, he used a very deep line, and this made it very difficult for the opposition to kind of get around them and try to get behind the defense to score goals. They'd really have to work through Catania's defense, whether on the flanks or trying to get some odd-man looks on either side, because the way they played so deep, it made it very difficult for any team to get in behind and get them on those breakaways. So Catania was very stout in that aspect. Now, Maran's systems are always very flexible, especially in the midfield. Depending on what looks he sees, he can go from one holding midfielder and two offensive midfielders to two holding midfielders and another one. He likes to change it up, change his diamond around. Depending on how many bodies he sees or what the opposition is showing him, he can adjust very much so, and is very flexible. He's not nailed down to one system. He doesn't make people play one way. He adapts to how the game is forming, how his opposition are lining up against him, which makes Maran very very modern in this sense. By having that kind of flexibility, this allows Rolando Maran and his teams to focus solely on the defense, make sure that they're stout. So when they're playing against teams who should be having more possession of the ball than they do, they tend to, you know, drop back in defense and really focus on that area and really kind of stifle the opposition. Now, on the contrary, when there are games when they're supposed to have the better possession of the ball, that midfield adapts and changes so that they can be have more possession, be more on the attack, and have that way, therefore, the wingers can push back up the field as well. Maran will definitely adjust to whoever he's playing. A lot of managers tend to just play one way. We're going to play my way or the highway, not Maran. Maran will adjust to the systems, which was very good for Catania. Catania had a lot of success at Catania, which ultimately led him to the Chievo job. So that job he did get was at Chievo. He took his modern version of the diamond to Chievo Verona. He continued using the 4-3-1-2 or the 4-3-3. No star player at his disposal at Chievo, but he continued to do what got him there to that job. Early on at Chievo, there's a lot of successes because really Chievo, you know, after a season or two, they were really playing some high level football under Rolando Maran. They didn't look like a mid table team, which, you know, with their place in the table said that they were. The way they played football, it was very attractive. Very high-level football. It wasn't simple at all, which a lot of the credit goes to the manager. So this modern diamond he used, with no star at his disposal, he tended to rely heavily on his trequartista, then to be two players, really, be Valtabirsa and Lucas Castro. Lucas Castro, the name you'll hear a lot more, because Lucas Castro followed him from Catania and would follow him also to Cagliari later on. But we'll get to that. So he used both Bierce and Castro as his tres artistas. They were interchanged during a game. When one of them saw that they had more of an opening than the other, they would take over as a tres artista. And this would really be a formation that would adapt during the game, would make it very hard to defend against, because you never know who's going to be pulling the strings for Kiev early on. Especially early on in his reign, 2014-15 and 15-16, those two would interchange, and both those players had showed a lot of success under this system. Now, defensively, offensively, they'd be a 4-3-1-2 or a 4-3-3. Defensively, it would be a 4-3-3, and the reason for this is they could put Walter Biesta or Lucas Castro, or whoever is being the trequartista at the time, to lead the counterattacks once they regain possession. They put Bierce or Castro up at the top. So once they get the ball breaks, they can take off and kind of pull the strings from there and let the attackers get open so they could feed them. This proved very successful for Chievo Verona at the beginning. So as we alluded to in the beginning, Chievo was very successful. They finished ninth place in the 2015-2016 season, which is pretty good for a team with no stars whatsoever. But because of the lack of star power, the lack of playmakers, injuries to key players like Lucas Castro, that really saw Chievo over the next several seasons decline. Whether it was lack of being able to understand Maran's complex system, it was not a simple system by any stretch, and not having playmakers on the team made it difficult to see the plays through and get the plays where they needed to be done. It was just lack of fundamental play by these players that caused constant turnover, led to the opposition scoring many goals against them. And ultimately, this led to Maran's firing, because in the 2017-2018 season, Maran would get the axe by Chievo on April 29th. They were bottom of the table. They're certainly getting relegated. So Chievo said, that's enough. Maran is gone. Chievo ultimately did get relegated to Serie B. And many wondered, including me, would this be the end of Maran? Would this be a major setback in his career? Because up until this point, he was having many successes. And from Catania with no star power there, although he did have Papu Gomez there. And then going over to Chievo, he was having initial success. And then this is a major setback, getting relegated and having your team not respond to you whatsoever. I wonder really if this was going to be a setback in his career, and we'd maybe never see him play in Serie A again. That didn't last too long, did it? June of 2018, Cagliari signs Rolando Maran as their manager, which was big for Cagliari. Cagliari also struggled near relegation zone. They took a chance on a manager who just got his team relegated the season before, but they did not leave him in the water dead for wanting, because Chievo did not supply him with any star players, did not give him any help around, so he had to work with what he had. Cagliari said, nah, we're going to spend some money and we're going to get him the help that he needs. So they brought in reinforcements. Before they got the reinforcements, though, they got rid of their star player, Barella. He got shipped off to Inter for a big, big lump of money. But what they did is they invested wisely in the money they got for Barella. So what they did first was they brought back an old face from Inter, loaned Raja Nainggolan back to Sardinia, where he kind of got his claim to fame before he went to Roma. So he was back on the island. They brought in Marco Rogue. They brought in Cristian Oliva. They brought in Nahit Hernandez from Argentina to really solidify that midfield. Maran, being plagued with injuries in the past, knew he needed a competent backup goalkeeper. And at the time, it was very questionable. Robin Olsen was brought in from Roma. His debacle at Roma, he was outcast from there. So they brought in Robin Olsen to back up Cranio. But it did end up proving to be a resurgence in Olsen's career, because Cranio did go down with injury during the season, and Olsen picked up, and he was really transformed his career back to kind of the prospect that people many hoped that he was when he was back in Sweden. So that was an excellent pickup for them. We mentioned Lucas Castro was brought on from Chievo. It's one of Maran's guys. They also brought in Cacciatore, and as well as they got from Juventus, Luca Pellegrini, to play left back. So some very talented players now at his disposal. Now many wonder how he would do with these guys. But on paper, many people in the preseason, including myself and Frank, we predicted that Cagliari would have a resurgence this season, maybe mid-table or even pushing for European places. And boy, did they prove us right. Now, last piece of the puzzle was getting an attacker. a competent attacker. And really, they got it from Fiorentina. They got Giovanni Simeone to round out their three man attack. So the three man attack could be Simeone, João Pedro, who's already been in Cagliari, and Raja Nainggolan. Really, they would use João Pedro and Nainggolan on the wings, and use Simeone as the lone attacker up front. And really, they would work interchangeably, all taking turns, and who would make the run as the attacker. But yeah, those two guys would start out wide and feed the ball into the guy to the lone striker. This has proven very good for Cagliari throughout the season. No matter who they play, they can interchange, and mostly it's been João Pedro or Simeone up in attack, but all three players are really interchanged throughout the game and flip sides, and so it puts the defense on their heels because they don't know really where these three players are going to be at any given opportunity or any given time. So Moran makes sure his teams always have viable options for passing no matter what, because they like to put pressure on the opposition, force turnovers, and then allow their players, once they regain possession, to have two or three options around them to get the ball moving quickly into the attacking end, into the box, and trying to get a scoring opportunity. Much like Moran's teams at Catania and Chievo, he used a regista in Luca Cigarini in this instance to really ignite the offense and lead their team from more to a direct attack style of play. Cigarini would pick up the ball in the defense. The two fullbacks would push up the pitch. And then quickly, Cigarini would pass the ball up the pitch to get the ball going and get the attack going right away. None of this, a lot of registas nowadays, they take the ball and slowly play it out. Very possession-based. This possession-based offense is very direct. So Cigarini gets the ball and quickly plays it up the field to get the attack going. Every now and then, the defense reads on this and puts their players surrounds Cigarini, so they have to go for another option. So Cranio or Robin Olsen in this case would play a long ball, a direct ball, down to the attackers. The attackers would hold the ball up, allow the midfielders, the tireless midfield really, to overlap them and then create chances down the field on either on a 2-on-1 or a 3-on-2, but always with the numbers. Always leading from a long ball from the goalkeeper to the attacker, like in most cases Simeone, where he'd hold it up and let the midfielders run past him, and he feeds him with a nice pass for a breakout opportunity. This plan A and this plan B for Cagliari proved very successful in their campaign thus far. Now, a major reason for Cagliari's success this year have been because of the midfield. The midfield, they run tirelessly for 90 minutes. They help out in the defensive phase, they help in the attacking phase. They really make the jobs for the defenders and the attackers that much more easier, that much more simpler, because they're helping out so well in different aspects of the game. They know the fundamentals so well. They contribute so much on both ends of the pitch. It really makes Cagliari a formidable squad to play against, both offensively and defensively. And many of their midfielders, like Nahit Hernandez, are picking up goals that Cagliari wasn't picking up in the past. And so the all-around play by their team, mostly led by their midfield, but the overall, the team is playing so well. They're a very well-oiled machine right now, making Moran look like a genius that we thought he was initially before the whole Chievo setback. So talk about a plan A, we talked about a plan B. There's also plan C, where the attackers would make runs in behind the defenders, and then the midfield or the fullbacks would find long balls over the top to reach them now for the counter opportunities or attacking opportunities. They use this quite a bit too. So plan A, plan B, plan C. There's a plan D as well. I told you, it's a very complex system with Moran. When all those options are taken, one of their favorite options really is going down the flanks with the fullbacks when they're passing up the middle from the run from behind with the attackers is taken. The fullbacks maraud down the pitch and cross it in for either a header or some kind of scoring opportunity in the box. So really have four viable options for Cagliari. That's why it makes them so difficult. If you look at the statistics, the chances aren't that many during a game, but they're very clinical on the ones that do finish. Will this last the whole season? That is the question. Will it hold up? I don't know. But so far it has. Impressive wins against Napoli, against Atalanta, and just to name a few, some of the big results they've had this season. They're up to fourth place in the table. Yes, fourth place. They have the fourth Champions League spot right now in the table. Will it last? I don't know. They got a big matchup against Lazio this weekend on Monday, so we'll see if that continues to go. But as right now, this is an impressive season for Moran. If Moran makes European spot, whether it's Champions League or Europa League, he deserves to be manager of the year, in my opinion. This the work he's done with them. It's going to be interesting to see if this can hold up throughout the season. I believe they have the pieces in place that they can make a long, successful run this season, that they will have a European spot. The question remains, they'll be on that borderline of fourth and fifth, because Roma is playing very well this year. Lazio are playing lights out, including Inter and Juventus. So that fourth and fifth spot is going to be up for grabs, I think, between Roma and Cagliari. Either way, it's going to be a successful season for Cagliari, a successful season for Rolando Maran. I'm ecstatic to see what Cagliari can do, because the island has always been a difficult place to play. Now they're showing they can play. They got the chops to play on the road as well. So fun things to come for Cagliari fans. And if you're a Rolando Maran fan, you really should be, because this guy plays a complex, attacking, modern diamond system that you should really get on board with and really watch Cagliari, because it is fun to watch and they have many, many viable options that they can use in a game. They can't get pinned down to one way, so that makes them very difficult to play against. So, yes, tell us what you thought about this manager analysis, Rolando Maran. Who do you want to see next? Deserbi is an option. Do you want to see some player profiles? Leave comments, let us know. And if you haven't done so yet, please subscribe. It would be very appreciated. Both Frank and I work very hard behind the scenes, both in the podcast and with the YouTube page, to try to provide you guys content that you guys would like to see. So let us know in the comments. Make sure you follow us on Serie A Sit Down on Twitter and Instagram as well. We try to keep constant updates there with you. And then, as always, if you're not listening to the podcast, you should. We're everywhere. Anywhere that streams music, we're there. Apple Podcasts, SoundCloud, Spotify, Stitcher Radio. I mean, you name it, we are there. So make sure you go there, give us a follow, subscribe, give us comments, likes on our podcast as well. And as always, ragazzi, make sure you tell your paisans about us. Ciao. Make it better.